from Tom. He says, "Hello, Trainer Road. I've been trying to lose some weight, but the idea of the idea you keep bringing up is that the same watt per kilogram being heavier is almost always better. And I totally agree because more watts sounds way cooler than less weight, eh?" He says, "My question, however, would be how would you go about it? For instance, do you eat more and just hope for the best, like bulking up in the gym, full body or not? Any other ideas? Thank you from Tom."
I'm just giggling because, like, do you just eat more and hope for the best? And Alex just started laughing right away and looking up. And I'm just thinking about the precision mentality versus that statement. It's a good contrast.
Nate and I's approach would probably just be Popeyes for breakfast, lunch, and dinner for a week.
It's bulking. It's productive.
Yeah. Amber, I just imagine those, like, bodybuilders with the ice cream. You know, it's like, oh, just bulk it up.
That's it. Right. Amber, you the episode we did with Ben Jacquemain would be good for this, right?
Absolutely. I think that's a really good one. And in that episode, as a just a preview, but I really recommend listening to the whole thing because he did exactly this, and not intentionally, but he did it a little bit by accident. He was coming back from injury and he was concerned about being in really good shape for team camp. So he just went out and trained as hard as he could. And he knew that in order to train as hard as he could day over day, he was going to have to really replenish what he was burning every day. So he, for the first time in his career, let go of, you know, constraining how much he was eating and really just made sure that he was fueling plenty to go out and just ride crazy hard every day, day in, day out, day in, day out. And he got super strong and he was heavier than he'd been as well. But what he found was the robustness of his fitness was at a totally different level. So instead of just, you know, not only was he now the first to the top of the climb, but he didn't have to, you know, he recovered so much faster after getting to the top of the climb first that he was also able to be really effective on the flats after the fact. So, It was a really cool eye-opening experience that he had on accident. And I think that there's a lot of really powerful learnings from that. So I highly recommend listening to that episode because I think it goes to this point and it talks specifically about how he did that on accident, but you could also try the same thing on purpose.
Mm-hmm. It's about training your body and putting your body in the position or training your body to do more work. And to do that, you need to put your body in the best position to be able to do that more work. Mm-hmm. And that is, from this perspective at least, making sure that it's adequately nourished. So I think a lot of people, a lot of cyclists, would, if they just focused on making sure that they gave their body really healthy foods at high quantities or sufficient quantities of food, I bet that they would see their power go up a lot and they might see their weight go up. But I bet that in most cases, they'd actually see a power to weight increase. Like it would get better in most cases. Mm-hmm. I've absolutely been the person that's tried to run it too close to the line and like, oh, I can't, I'm just stuck at 310, 315 watts. And that's just my peak. That's what I'll be forever. And really, no, that's not the case. It's just for what I was fueling. That was the limiter and that was holding me back from being able to improve. But since I've improved my fueling, eating a ton of carbohydrate focused foods that are mostly plant-based and focused on getting a ton of variety and micronutrients and whole grains and vegetables and fruit, getting all of that, then my power goes up when I adequately fuel with that stuff. So I don't know. I wish that it was easy as just Popeyes, breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
It's easy. Trust me. Tom, we're in the same mindset here. Again, you can follow my Instagram, but triathlon, this does not work with triathlon. This does not work with Cape Epic, but for crits, as Pete being my, Pete and a whole bunch of other NorCal riders, Richard Jones being one of them too. The idea, you can be a great flat crit racer and have higher watts per kilo. And you can also be really good rolling road racer, right? It's hard when it gets to be the really long climbs, 40-minute climb, especially if it's really steep, that's going to be tougher for you, but you actually probably will win more because your power is so much higher. Right. Mm-hmm. So you're more like polarized in terms of how you can express your fitness, which is a good thing, I think, rather than being kind of straight down the middle. Mm-hmm. Now, Tom, to do this, you need to be in a caloric surplus to gain weight. And at the same time, you need two things to signal your body. One, you need like some kind of resistance training or aerobic training. And two, you need adequate protein. And for protein, this is how I would think about it, is I would shoot for 2 grams per kilogram of body weight. Yes, that per day. And then carbs, about, depending on how much you train, maybe 6 grams per kilogram of carbohydrate if you're like 2 hours per day, more if you're doing a little bit more than that. And then fat, probably 1 gram per kilogram body weight. Now, you have that the whole time, and then you need a caloric surplus. So the extra calories can come from whatever you want. And I wouldn't really care too much where you get these from, like which macronutrient. Just do what is good for you, or what is interesting and what you want to eat. Now, at the same time, I would do weightlifting, and I would do try to get your lower body stuff lined up where it's not immediately before a hard day. I actually like it if you did a hard workout in the morning and then an evening like a leg session, that'd be best. And I would do some upper body training. I don't need science to back this up, but I see, it's like, at least in the amateur ranks, you see people who raise their upper body strength and like their whole body gets stronger and their FTP does go up, even though there's no sense in that at all. And
we're not talking turning into Arnold. Connected. You're not talking like turning into like a bodybuilder, upper body strength, right?
No, but the bigger riders, they always have some upper body mass too. Pete, you know, being a good example of that. And maybe you can do this crazy thing where you gain it all in your legs and none in your upper body. That's I don't see that in the amateur ranks very often. Maybe at the Cat 1 level, who's kind of like domestic pro. But it's also kind of fun to have some more upper body strength, and it will help probably in sprinting. It helps in mountain biking, long triathlons, a whole bunch of stuff. So that's what I would basically, because you want to, in your caloric surplus, you want to put on muscle, right? And you need to have, like, the most important thing would be to get that protein at 2 grams per kilogram body weight. More than that isn't really going to help. And less than that, you're probably leaving gains on the table. And another way to think about it is if you just kind of do a rule of thumb for protein. So you say, you know, this much chicken is about 20 grams and you kind of keep that in your head all day. You can use whey protein if you're, or like a pea protein if you're vegan. But if you're vegan, you have to do a little bit more to kind of supplement that. And because it can be hard to get enough meat or protein. I know you get it through other things too, but the easiest for a carnivore is to, or omnivore is to do sure. meat and then some whey protein. And then, yeah, it's, you get your carbs on the bike, you get your recovery shake in, and then you just get to eat a little bit of a treat or something else in the other parts of the day. And that's probably a good way. I just don't go too fast. If you go too fast, it's a lot easier to put on a bunch of body fat, which is then probably not what you're aiming for.
Yeah. Alex, this is an interesting question that I wanted to pose to you, because in most cases, most of us are FTP constrained. You are not particularly FTP constrained. So like for me, doing this makes sense because I have room where I can raise my FTP further, right? This sort of a thing. But for you, do you ever toy around with this? Like, do you ever think like, or do you intentionally put yourself into surpluses to be able to gain more weight, to chase better performance? Or is that how you've gotten to where you are? Because your FTP is ridiculously high. So,
Yeah, I kind of take a different approach. I don't actively try to put on weight. And I've definitely been in the boat probably 2 years ago now, last time we raced, 2019, of trying to ride that line of being super light. And I just focused on fueling the work. So I'm sure it's no secret by now. I weigh everything. I track my macros. And as long as I'm hitting those, I barely weigh myself like anymore. I used to weigh myself every morning and night and then maybe sometimes during the day. Wasn't a healthy relationship with that machine. But for now, it's just like, can I hit the numbers? Can I do the workout kind of thing? And like now I have this workout twice a week that I'm burning 3,700 calories in 3 hours. I never would have been able to do that at 65 kilos. So it's just making sure that I have the fuel on board and that I know what I need to execute that workout. So for me, it's not necessarily about trying to hit that 500 calorie surplus, but I mean, in our house, we have a cheat meal probably about once a week. Like, and by cheat meal, I mean just like whatever we want. I enjoy food a lot. So trust me, I eat plenty of foods. It's just more just like something where it's like, I've hit my macros for the day, or this will hit my macros for the day in one way or another and go over them, and it's fine. So I've never tried to gain weight. And for Tom, it sounds like he was trying to lose weight. So before going all the way to the other side to trying to gain weight, I would try to first like fuel the work and hit those workouts and kind of see where you shake out and kind of go from there.
Mm. I've taken this year a different approach for me. I'm not measuring macros at all. What I do is I check in the first week of every month, and I just usually measure for as long throughout that week as I need to be able to make sure that I'm still on track basically with my portions. But basically all I do is I try to make sure that I just stuff myself full of veggies. And if I bring in as many vegetables as possible and starchy carbs and grains, that sort of stuff, if I bring in that and I'm trying to get as much variety as possible, then I'm almost always in a good place as long as I'm making sure that I'm fueling the work I'm doing on the bike too. And I'm actually the leanest I've been this year, that I've ever been, that I can think of. And that is being done not with more attention to detail and more time on the scale and more time measuring macros. It's less of all of that. Instead, it's focusing on quality of food and making sure I'm fueling the work. If I'm doing that, I'm also doing more work than I ever have, just a higher FTP. So it's all going toward me being not only a better athlete, but also I'm just like I feel better in general too. I'm not constantly run down. So this is always Absolutely. Like a tricky thing on balances and where people want to do this, but of all things, just make sure you're giving yourself quality whenever you can, and then your body's going to be a lot happier. So
yeah. Amber, what is your weight gaining plan?
My weight gaining plan is to make a whole new human being.
there is like, you need a caloric surplus, right? And I'm guessing you're just going by hunger rather than anything specific.
Yeah, I've actually really just been letting my body take the lead on this one. Believe it or not, I do take my own advice from time to time. I think I want to just say one thing. The calibration thing is important. And what I mean by that is, for example, when I was racing, I thought I had it nailed. I thought I was eating really well. I thought I was feeling well. And then one year I got a bee in my bonnet and just said, I want to work with a nutritionist and like really get this dialed in. And the first thing he had me do was hit a protein intake goal for the day. That was one of the first changes we made. And I could not believe how little protein I was eating compared to what he thought I needed. And I couldn't believe how much better I felt when I started eating that. And I couldn't believe how hard it was to get from where I was to where he was recommending. It was it was one change, and you would think that's kind of minor, but it required a substantial change in habits and expectation, but it completely changed how I felt on the bike for the better. But the baseline that I'd become accustomed to, the way that my body was expecting food, the way that I felt on the bike and the way that my body was using the fuel that I was taking in was vastly different from where it could be. So, and those changes are really hard to make. So I would suggest that make one small change at a time, because even a small change can be really substantial in terms of the effort that goes into building a new habit or replacing one. And it's going to take some experimentation. So let's say you want to increase your protein intake. And I know we're kind of hammering on that, but it's an easy example to use. Different protein sources are going to make you feel very different. So like Nate said, there's going to be, you know, constraints if you're a vegetarian, vegan or not. And even within those constraints, figuring out what the protein sources and the timing are that are really going to work well for your body, because this is, again, very highly individual. And I would just say that sometimes the signaling that we get is a little bit different. So circling back to what I'm doing now, I really had some time after I stopped racing to allow my body to settle back in and to allow some of those signaling systems to kind of recalibrate and get back online again in a natural way. Because oftentimes we find ourselves like really trying to override those systems, and it can kind of throw them out of whack over time. Mm-hmm. So I feel like I'm in a really good place personally where I can let my body take the lead and really listen to like what my body's asking for, listening, you know, listening, you know, tuning into those satiety cues and those hunger cues, it feels really good. Yeah. And I don't feel like I'm eating that much more than I normally do, but I feel really happy and nourished. And that's kind of, that's all I'm going for right now. It feels good.
That's awesome. I'm so excited. Small Amber.
On the protein side of things too, a little thing that I found was if you're a coffee drinker and an omnivore, I think for collagen, but putting that in your coffee in the morning is an extra 10 grams. So that helps. Yeah. And then, but like you said,
the thing about collagen is there's some muscle building scale and it goes between 1 and I think 0 and 10, but collagen ranks as a 0. So collagen should not be included in your protein for muscle improvements.
Interesting. Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting. That sounds like something that came from mass, probably, huh?
It did, actually.
Yeah. Stronger by Science guys. Yeah, great.
And then back to TT bikes and power. I have this not backed by science theory that your CDA is pretty set on a bike, right? Like unless you change your fit. So I don't think your CDA is going to change like for 5 to 10 pounds, you know, be in your face, maybe your legs, that belly, maybe. I don't know. But you're going to cut through the air all the same. So if you as a rider are 65 kilos and doing 4 watts per kilo or 70 kilos doing 4 watts per kilo, I would argue in most situations or all situations at that point, you'd be going faster and it would be everywhere. You'd be going faster on the flats, anywhere up to a 7% climb. You're going to be going faster than the same 4 watts per kilo. And then anything above, you'd be at least doing the same. Mm-hmm. So food for thought.
Mm-hmm. Definitely depends on the type of racing you're doing.
Yeah. For Cape Epic, I should just shoot for the moon. 200 pounds, 400 watts. I know climbs are more than 7% though, which is kind of annoying, but I will go so fast in the downhills. If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.